Yes, well, here I am in the dining part of the front room here. It's sort of off in the corner of the front room, you know, where it goes into the kitchen. And I think I'll use that elevation. Thank you. And there's some flowers I got for Easter. And they came here just 2 days. Three days before my mom died. That was 2 weeks ago. And this is the third or the fourth little video. I say little because it's only 3 or 4 or 5 minutes long. The third or fourth little video log I've tried to make, I have made, and I'm making again the fourth or the fifth or something. Trying to talk of the different events and how they manifest themselves in our lives, as we have all these things we must do, even at a moment of strong grief. I have found, even as fortunate as we have been here, I have felt and found that it is a very powerful hurt, a loss of this, even when expected, although not quite anticipated this week, but still it cuts off the person from your world, and it's done. It is, grief is a thing of such great power that I can only compare it to love as a force that is in our lives and moves us. Love, grief, these are among the most overwhelming of feelings and changes. Suddenly the whole world has moved and the sea has changed, and it is another life after one of us is lost. It is another life. The sun is setting into fog clouds. We can still see it here, but I believe the shadows are coming closer, and certainly the shadow of night is rising in the east. As the earth comes up in the west to cover the sun. I had thoughts, oh, I'll talk about the technical problems, and I'll talk about the emotional difficulties, and I'll talk about the people who help one way or another, about the great blessing of family. And here again is that power of love. And one of my strongest feelings is simply gratitude. Thanks to God for this change that did not hurt her much, she said, "I'm going to fall down," as I was helping her get up in the bathroom to go back to bed. And she fainted. Almost 2 weeks ago, the day of Wednesday night, she passed on Friday afternoon, a week and 5 days ago. It was the week before Easter. It was all the more difficult for that, and all the more thankful for that. I'm marveling, as sometimes I do. I don't see the sunset every night, no. Many a night I've been doing something else. But this was my mother's favorite spot. For many years she sat here. Nearly all the 10 years I was here, she sat here. In this time of day, enjoying the sunset and her cocktail. I am glad these flowers got here before she died. This house now is the center of a long and difficult labor of Hercules to count and distribute 1,000 pieces of furniture . And let me tell you something. This house is not all. My parents, for 30 years, and before then, my stepfather, for 20 years before then, drove around the country in a motorhome. He called it Horizon. I think that was the name of it. The brand, even. And he collected things as he drove. And then he married my mother, and they drove around. And after 10 years, they got another motorhome, because the first one, Horizon, was old and it had broken 100 times. Well, more than that. So my stepfather figured out a way to afford to buy this new motorhome. Now, of course, the taxes helped because, you know, he had to give away the old one and get a tax break. So it still cost him a penny or two. And he bought this new motorhome, and he and my mom drove around in it. Sometimes one of my stepbrothers would go with him. My brother went with him. I went with him a couple of nights, but not on long trips. They drove with my brother George. They drove to the Arctic Circle up, you know, north of Canada. They didn't go to Alaska. They went into Canada. And they drove there. They drove. And that wasn't the only place they went. They went all over. Well, my stepfather, for the years before he married my mother, and then him and my mother have been collecting all this stuff. Well, all the furniture in the old motorhome, it was all the stuff, the pots and the pans and the knives and the forks and the plastic knives and forks and the plastic plates and pans and the all this stuff was old. So they got more. And they got new stuff for the new motorhome. Huh. I still sounds like some sort of American dream fairy tale. You retire and drive around the country and look at all the beautiful places in the world. Well, in this continent in the world. Imagine if you could drive a motorhome all the way around the world. Well, hell, just maybe drive an SUV, okay? Because some of the roads are a little rough. All the way around the world in an SUV with your refrigerator running on a little solar panel, and you could drive all the way around the world like that. No. Well, you'd have to go from Turkey into Iran and then into Pakistan. You couldn't go into Afghanistan. Back in the 60s, they used to talk about driving through Afghanistan to drive to India. Well, you have to take a different road today. And there's still mines and soldiers and bandits and robot bombs flying by overhead. Anyhow, I don't think you could drive a motorhome around the world, even if you had a boat to put it on. But I think about them now that I have all this stuff here that we have to sort and distribute, and I just don't want to put it all in another storage unit. That's a lot of money wasted on stuff piled up. Why don't we just go through it and give some of it away and sell some of it away and take some of it away for each of ourselves and I turned off the heat in the house. You might hear the air conditioner, excuse me, not the air conditioner, the refrigerator. You might hear the refrigerator running over there in the kitchen. It's right over there. And I turned off the heat, and I'll wait and see this summer if I can not turn on the air conditioning. That's when it gets bad with me, is when it gets hot. No, I've got lots of fat blanket. Cold's not as bad as the hot. Anyhow, I don't want to pay that bill, so I turned it off. I'm going to straighten up my mom's bedroom. That's almost done. And her bathroom, which is the master bathroom, my parents' bathroom and bedroom. And then I'm going to move, once that's in pretty good shape, I'm going to move to another room. And I'm just kind of organizing things and getting them off the floor because they've been in piles and stuff. My mom used the bathroom as her closet because she couldn't go into the closet and pull back the heavy wooden door and reach up and lift up the suit off the rack. So she hung them on the towel racks in the bathroom. And that was how she still looked so good, even in her 90s. Because she had her clothes fixed so she could get them real easy. Yeah. The last year or two, it took a lot longer for her to get ready. We didn't go much anymore, but she still had collars, and she still got herself dressed, and she took a bath up until a few months ago. And then she decided she didn't want to fall down, so she stopped taking baths. We had, when the nurses came over end of last year, we also had a person come to help Mom take a shower, and she did that twice. And then she said no, she doesn't want people to come and help her. And recently, this month especially, but ever since Christmas, I've been thinking it's time to have a professional health caregiver come in at least once a week and give Mom a bath in the shower. You know, there's a seat in there and all that stuff. Wash her and check on her to see if her skin's okay. And I finally got her to agree last month. Well, she agreed okay. And I had the appointment set for the first interview for this guy to come, and they were going to send a man, and he called the day before, and I agreed, okay, we'll see you at 3:30, and that was in the morning, I think. And then it was in the afternoon, about 3 or 3:30, when Mom decided she could get up and go to the toilet. And it took about 10 minutes for her to sit up and catch her breath, because that was her biggest problem, was being so short of breath. And then she could stand up in her walker and slowly move across the room into the bathroom and turn around and sit down. She said, okay, I'm okay. You can go for a while now. I'll just sit here. And that's what she did. So it was about half an hour later, she called me in. And I said, hello, you ready? Get up. I want to go back to bed. And, well, let's pull up your pants. And I saw then that her panties, the little undergarments that absorb urine and liquids and stuff, they're called Depend. I saw it was wet, it was yellow, stained yellow, and there was a little spot, one little spot of, I'm having a deja vu. I think I already put this detail in a vlog. So I said, we have to change your panties, and we did. And her legs, she picked up her foot to help me take the panty off and put the new one on, and the other foot, obviously. And then she had a hard time standing up. And the last thing she said was, I'm going to fall.